John, the fifth chapter tonight. This will be our 58th exposition in this book. We're going to be in verses 5 through 9. The incident concerning an impotent man at the pool of Bethesda. Now in our text, Jesus is, as Peter reported, going about doing good and healing all that were possessed of the devil. That's what he was doing. He was doing works that bore witness that he was of God.
Amen.
They were also bearing witness to the fact that God had sent him. These are the words that he said when he was here, that his works testify to this. He said concerning his works, I must work the works of him that sent me. I must. The conditions weren't exactly conducive to this. Even if there were multitudes following him, a lot of them were just curious. So the environment wasn't conducive to working the works of God. That's what I'm saying. But see, he said, I must.
Amen.
I must work the works of God. These are works that if you believe them, you had to believe the works. Jesus said, believe the works. If you believe the works, they'd testify to you that God was in him and he was in God. But you couldn't see them as like just like a wonder. You had to see them like what they really were. Now, Jesus said something concerning his works that is particularly important. He said he did the works which none other man did. Now, this is like a buried truth. Jesus did things nobody else ever did. The work of God in man, particularly the man Christ Jesus, is not something anyone else can do. This has got to be seen. It's absolutely unique.
Yes.
No one else could do the works Jesus did. No one else could do the works people Jesus sent did. Nobody else could do them. It's important to know this because Satan has been very aggressive in destroying this idea so that the church has become bogged down in doing things that there's other people can do. And the church is bogged down in these kind of things, professing church. And they're made to feel guilty if they don't. But after all said and done, there isn't a man on earth or an angel in heaven that can support the postulate that the church is ever intended to busy itself with doing things that other people can do. That's not why it's here. It's in spite of what people say. God has made men so that men can have compassion on men. I mean, that you don't have to be in Christ to know that. But what the church is to do cannot be done by anybody else.
Yeah,
not government, not senators, not charitable works. It just can't. Mm-hmm. It's an absolute unique work. Now, this is my own judgment, but I think I could support this if asked to do so. There is entirely too much earthly normality in today's church. It's just too normal. Too vague, too blurred. The line between the people of God and the world is too blurred.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's too hard to detect.
Yeah.
Too difficult to identify. Now, this strongly suggests that what is seen is not really the church. It's the world dressed up like a church. That is all the difference in the world between those two. Now, we're not to arbiters, to be judges, to make lists and all this. Understand what I'm saying. That a church that's not unique is at the very best a bad church. That'd be the best view. Maybe they left the first love. It's still a church, but left the first love. But if they continue in that, it won't continue to be a church. Now, I know this is hard to say. Some people can't say it, but I can say it without any reservation. A church that doesn't give light doesn't have light.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
That's why it doesn't give any.
That's right.
Even the world doesn't hide light it's got.
Uh-huh.
No man lights a candle and puts it under a bushel.
Yeah.
So don't think that God's people have managed to become expert in this.
Uh-huh.
No light shining, no light existing. Uh-huh. That's the way it is. If it gives light, it's because it has light. Now in our text, we're going to see the uniqueness of Christ, the absolute uniqueness of him. He's going to do something nobody else can do. I pray for a renewal of this type of thing. Our text is pardon? 5-9, yeah. Jesus has just come to the pool of Bethesda. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another steppeth down before him. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath.
Yeah.
Now the precision with which Jesus worked has long intrigued me, and it still does, how it was so specific it was and how unique it was. The ministry of Jesus and his presence was totally without ambiguity. There was no vagueness, no uncertainty, no equivocalness, no dubiousness. Not about Jesus. People see things they'd never seen before, but that was quite clear what they saw.
Yeah.
The miracles which he did were always clear and successful. The blind came away seeing, the deaf came away hearing, the dumb came away speaking. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
The lepers weren't lepers anymore. The insane weren't insane anymore. See, that's it was just a good work. Characterized by certainty and specificity. And I want to just take a moment and deal with this. Establish that it was very specific, very effective, very noticeable. We read of, for instance, a certain scribe, a certain ruler, a certain man, a certain woman, a certain poor widow, a certain priest, a certain city, a certain day, a certain Pharisee, a certain lawyer, a certain village, a certain place, a certain Pharisee, a certain blind man, a certain maid, a certain nobleman in a certain season. See, see how specific,
right.
How specific it was. Now, what I want to address here is that these certainties is what made the works of Jesus discernible. If it was just general, they couldn't be detected. But these certainties, a certain this in a certain place, a certain time, a certain city, certain region, that's what made the works of Christ observable.
Yeah.
That's how you could see them. And only Jesus can operate like this. You try and do this, you'll encounter a little more difficulty. Divine power was gathered, so to speak, focused on a certain place, certain time, certain person, so that this power could be observed and made known. So people could, like, think upon it.
Yes.
See how different it was. See how effective it was. See? It had to be seen. And that's what made it seeable. This is why the psalmist wrote, "He hath made his wonderful works to be remembered." See? But they're always associated with a certain person, certain time, certain place, certain city, certain region. See, that's how we remember the things.
Yes.
That's how we remember it. So when there are specific answers to prayer, that now you know something that you may not have known as clearly before.
Right.
Now, it's the peculiar prerogative of faith to see what's hard to see. Faith can look at what Jesus does, and it can see something nobody else sees. Someone else will just see a wonder. They'll see a wonder or some phenomenon. But a person with faith, he's able to detect something in what Jesus did.
Yeah,
man. Well, that's way. That's wonderful. Now, there's room for improvement in this area, as you all know. Now, here in our text, located in one of the five porches of the Pool of Bethesda, there was a man among a multitude. One man among a multitude. Remember, it said that at the Pool of Bethesda, on these five porches or colonnades, covered areas, there was a great multitude of impotent folk, blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water, which John tells you was an angel came down at a certain time. It evidently was kind of sporadic. The angel came down. The angel went into the pool, the scripture says, agitated the pool in a way that was very observable. And whenever the people saw that water moving, whoever got in, they had to get in the pool now. Whoever got in the pool first was healed of whatever disease they had. But on this day, on any day that happened, only one could be healed.
Yeah.
Right? But on this day, there was only one going to be picked out.
Yeah.
Only one. A lot of people had needs.
Mm-hmm.
One.
Yeah.
This probably happened to you at some time.
Uh-huh.
There was a lot of people needed grace, and you got it.
Yeah.
Don't sit and scratch your head about it.
Amen.
Give God thanks. A multitude has needs, but only one is going to have them met this day. It was like Jesus reminded people in his hometown synagogue. He says, now, in the days of Elijah, there were many widows.
Yeah.
There were many widows in Israel. But a Gentile widow in Sidon is the one that was blessed.
Uh-huh.
And there were many, the days of Elisha, the prophet, he said there were many lepers in Israel.
Uh-huh.
But Naaman the Syrian. This is God.
That's right.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
I've seen things like this happen. It always drew my attention. I was a member of the one true church. That's what I was a member of. Where the true, we could trace it back to 31 A.D. Some cornerstones even had that on the cornerstones. Yeah? Yeah. Invariably, I'd encounter somebody from another church that would see things I hadn't seen. I won't name the churches, but they were from another group, but they had insight I didn't have. It was like the widow of Sidon and Naaman the leper, Naaman the Syrian, see?
Yeah.
See, God's not, he's going to heal everybody at once.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't have had the impact that this has had, this record has had down through history.
Amen.
Throughout scriptures, there's been special cities like Nineveh. See? When you hear about Nineveh, you think of something special. There's been special islands like Crete.
Yeah.
Paul said to Titus, I left you in Crete. There's been special women like Lydia. Special men like Cornelius. Special regions like Macedonia. See, God's always worked. He's always worked this way. Why? Because that's what makes his works observable. That's how you can see them and detect them and diagnose them. That's why they stand out. Now, this man had an infirmity. He was impotent, paralyzed, we might say. Some versions read he was sick, he has sickness. NIV says he was an invalid. The New Revised Standard Version says he was ill. The Geneva Bible says he was diseased. And that Bible says he was disabled. Young's Literal Translation said he had an ailment. And I'm showing you this to show you how much trouble translators have with stuff like this. They don't know how to they don't know how to say something that's hopeless. The Apostolic Bible says feebleness. And the Amplified Bible says a deep-seated and lingering disorder. See, all of those are like modified. I don't like stuff like that. I like impotent.
Yeah.
Just come right out and call it what it is.
Right.
If it needs Jesus' help, it can't be like some kind of a common condition.
That's
not it. It was a debilitating condition. By its very nature, it got worse and worse and worse. It was a fitting likeness of sin. And those people will no doubt make this connection. Sin's like that. It debilitates and it keeps getting worse and worse and worse. See, that sin's just like that. So that the physical effects of sin parallel the spiritual effects of sin. We don't know how long this man was there, but evidently he'd been coming to the pool for a while. It says Jesus saw him. What is there about Jesus that he can look at a big crowd and spot one person? I mean, if it doesn't mean anything to you now, believe me when I tell you, you sometimes will have situations when you, that's exactly what you need. You need Jesus to focus his attention on you.
Amen.
And you are very aware of that. Well, it's just telling you, Jesus does this. Jesus does this. You can be right in the middle of a whole lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
And you say to yourself, I need help and I'm not getting to this place. And I wish Jesus would look at me.
Yeah.
All right, the gospel's telling you, he does things like this.
Amen.
Picks out a particular person. Jesus.
I think of what the psalmist said to this man, will I look.
That's
so
right.
He can focus.
Heck, you're looking for someone to look at.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
One of the days of Noah, he found one man.
Amen. Jesus saw him lying there. Now, this is the compassionate Savior. He saw him lying there. There may very well be a time when you'll think like this. Whether anyone in the whole world has helped or not, oh Lord, I need help.
Yeah, that's right.
you'll actually...
Amen.
Oh, yeah. If you haven't experienced this, believe me when I tell you, and many people here could testify to it. You can be in a situation like that. And this is not a bad situation because God is looking.
Yeah.
His eyes are roaming to and fro upon the face of the earth to show himself strong in behalf of those whose hearts perfect toward him. He's looking for a person that sees things like they really are.
Yeah.
And want the true resource of trouble. And it says he knew he'd been there a long time. He knew he'd been there a long time. Great length of time. So it specified 38 years. Now that itself is remarkable.
Yeah.
For a person to live with an infirmity for almost four decades.
Yeah.
That itself is most unusual.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
People with a debilitating disease don't normally last a long time. 3, 4, 5 years, maybe 10, maybe exceptionally 20, but normally a disease is getting worse and worse, finally catches up with the person and they pass away. That's just the way it is. The human constitution is remarkably strong. It takes a long time for a person to die. My mother had a stroke that completely debilitated her. So she couldn't do nothing but move her eyes. That was it. And it lasted 5 years. She was in that state for 5 years. Sister June had a relative that was debilitated for many years. Her parents took care of him, but he was in that, lasted for a number of years. But eventually, they passed away. So just for a man to have an infirmity like this for nearly four decades, that itself is... It was remarkable. It's almost like God kept him around to be a testimony.
That's right. Amen.
Some grow weary and give up. But this man is at the pool.
That's right.
He's at the pool.
Yeah. You can imagine how many people he must have at some point in time called and asked and had take him there. Because he couldn't go,
yeah,
right?
Right?
He had to have somebody. So... I know just when my mother was on dialysis, you know, friends are friends, but at some point in time they get tired of helping you.
Yeah, I know.
You know, I mean, it's just how long you're going to ask me to give up my life so that you know,
yeah.
You see what I'm saying? So this man, he got there somehow, some way.
Yeah.
He made sure he was there.
He hadn't given up.
Yeah.
Still there. So Jesus seeks him out. Must have walked through all this multitude. Now, I gather the multitude didn't recognize him. They probably were looking at the water, because every place else he walked, people would touch his garment, touch his clothes, touch his body, but nobody did that here. So I gather that they were all focused on that pool waiting for the water. So he walked among all these people, and he asked this poignant question. Wilt thou be made whole? Do you want to be well? See, some people maybe have never been asked that question. Sick people. Do you want to be made well? See, that's critical. The Amplified Bible says, are you really in earnest about getting well? He didn't come to the pool to see if other people got well, did you? You really want to be made well? Now remember, this man's illness commenced 7 years before Jesus was born.
That's right.
How about that? 7 years before Jesus was born, this man was in this condition.
Yeah.
Jesus sees this man like a bruised reed. So he asks a question that'll wake faith up. He asked a question that will arouse hope, cause it to sit up and expect. I do not doubt that Jesus still asks this question. The people that have some kind of difficulty, it may be a disease, it may be an infirmity of the soul. And if you just quiet down long enough, don't get caught up in complaining, you'll hear this voice speaking to your spirit, saying, would you like to be made well? I think I've heard that voice myself, and it's God's way of enlivening faith and hope, causing it to surface so that people don't despair. Well, the impotent man answers right away. He says, sir, now I got to admit that I don't particularly care for that translation, sir. Might interest you to know that that word is translated from the word kyrios, which means Lord. Interesting, isn't it? Nearly every version reads sir. There's a few exceptions, but not many. One version says Mr. Murdoch's translation. The Apostolic Bible says, O Lord, and the Contemporary English Version says, Lord. Most of the other versions, most all of them, at least 50 now that I checked, said, sir. Now, I wanted to give you the definition of the word translated, sir. Lord and Master. Generally, Lord, Master, one who has full control of something. As a respectful designation, is also used as addressing persons of varying social and political rank. Often equivalent to our word, sir. So I thought, well, I wonder what the English word, sir, what that means. Well, here's what it means. A man entitled to be addressed as sir uses a title before the given name of a knight or baronet, and formerly sometimes given a man of a priest or man of rank of position, used as a generally respectful form of address. Now, you'll hardly ever see a young person say, sir,
yeah,
in our country. Mm-hmm. You will hear it in other countries.
Yeah.
Term of designation. Now, I'm not sure why I use this word. I think he picked up on this was no ordinary man he was talking to. And so he addressed him as an extraordinary person. And he explained to him. He wanted to be healed, but he wasn't healed. He said, well, sir, I have no man to help me. It's the idea. I have no man to help me. Now, earlier, a paralyzed man in Capernaum, he had four men that were willing to help him. I said, but here's the man, I have no man, no one to assist him to get into the pool. There are people in conditions whom I think is by divine appointment are in a condition nobody else can help. Because sometimes God, he has to get a person in that position. Yeah, but James.
This situation is the epitome of hopelessness.
That's right.
Because of the system, the more infirmed you were, the less chance you had.
Yeah.
Somebody had a broken hand. They could jump in the pool.
Yeah.
You're completely paralyzed. You have the absolute worst chance.
Uh-huh. That's right.
So, to your point of things only Jesus can do, this man was never going to be that one. He could not get into the pool
get
of
in.
His own.
That's right.
And he had no one to help him.
Yeah. Helpless. That's right.
Yeah.
Now, I trust this is true of everybody here, that you've arrived at the point where you know that with Christ there's no such thing as hopelessness.
Yeah.
The door of hope, when Jesus died, opened up the door of hope.
Yes, and you know, before
we saw Jesus like that, we come to a place where we found that we were hopeless. There wasn't anything we could do about our sin. And yet, at that point in time is when Jesus became the most precious.
That's right.
Yeah.
You might say that Jesus is a specialist in hopeless things.
Amen.
Hopeless things. I have no man that could help me. Now, David one time, he talked about being in a condition nobody could help. This is found in the 7th Psalm, where David sang to the Lord concerning the words of Cush the Benjamite, O Lord my God, in thee I put my trust. Save me from all them that persecute me, and deliver me, lest they tear my soul like a lion, rending it to pieces while there's none to deliver. See, you know, there's... Yeah. Even David, a mighty warrior, he's a mighty warrior. He's backed in a corner. Nobody to help on earth. So he calls out to the Lord. David also experienced a time that paralleled Christ on the cross. In the 22nd Psalm, he says, there is none to help. None to help. So it's certainly an unpleasant thing to undergo, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's nobody to help. Faith's got to be kept alive, so when that time comes, you can survive. You can survive a hopeless condition.
I was thinking about your comment about the man, how long he'd been in this infirmity, and the fact that it was longer than Jesus had been alive in the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking about some other circumstances where there was a long time in the making of the circumstance that Jesus came to address.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want to put that on our own lives, that spotlight on our own lives, and consider when there's a long time of trial that the Lord is forming circumstance that Jesus can work through in that time.
That's right.
And so that the faith and the hope is so important in this time so that we don't lose sight of the Lord's working at the present for the culmination of his intention.
Yes, very good.
Amen.
You see, you can see this, that the works of Christ were made to integrate with the life of faith. See, it was a depiction of things that actually do occur in the spirit realm.
Yes.
And they can integrate with life. Now, when the thing I'm concerned about, the man says, when the water is troubled. I mean, I don't need any help until the water is troubled. That's when I need the help.
That's right.
And that's when I can't find any help. I have no man to help me into the pool. Now, I know that some people take the position that this was just folklore, that an angel really didn't come down at all. This is just a old folklore, old wise fable. But this was inspired by the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It's not the Spirit's nature to comment on human tradition.
That's right.
If you're familiar with Scripture, you should know that.
It is the Spirit of truth.
That's right. And if it is a human tradition, the Holy Spirit would just... These traditions held the elders. You know, they'll tell you about it. But this was really something that happened. It kind of opens the door for possibilities. Here's an angel associated with healing. How's that? Maybe some like an effective treatment is ministered to somebody.
That's right.
How do you know an angel didn't make that effective?
Right.
See?
Amen.
Anyway, this is how I like to think this way. So that whenever anything happens, I always give credit to the Lord. And knowing that here you have an incident now of an angel employed in the healing of people at a certain time. It was refreshing to think about anyway. If God be for us, I mean, who could be against us? Now, he said, while I'm coming... While I'm trying to get in, the NIV says, I'm making my way there, trying to get in. While I'm on the way down there, see, though impotent, there's some way in which he's making some progress. Now, back in 1980, when I was in 85, this happened too, when I was in India, I saw some impotent people who would drag themselves across the ground with their hands. They'd pull himself. Their arms weren't paralyzed. They'd pull himself. It was a pathetic sight to see. But they'd pull himself. And I gather that's something like this man. He's using whatever he could move, and he's trying to get to the pool. Must have taken a lot of effort to... See, don't be afraid to put out a lot of effort to get the blessing. You may have to wrestle for it like Jacob did, see? But don't be afraid to do that. Put out effort. Don't give up easily. But he never could manage to get there. He says, another step's down before me. So infirm people aren't necessarily compassionate. They need compassion, but they aren't compassionate necessarily. Yeah. Nobody that was there said, well, I'm willing. Let's all work together on this. We'll help you in, and tomorrow you can help me in. They didn't. They evidently didn't think that way at all. Sin does that to people. Sinners don't care about other sinners. It takes people in Christ to have a care, concern for sinners. Sinners don't have concern for sinners. Sometimes there's sympathy for physical situations, but see, this shouldn't have been the Jews. These were Jews. This is not how they should have reacted. The law taught them very specifically about being merciful. Here it is in Deuteronomy 15:7. If there be among you a poor man of one of thy brethren within any of thy gates in thy land, which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not hide in the harden thy heart, nor shut thine hand from the poor brother.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, there's a whole bunch of impotent folk when they shut their eyes to this man here. See, even though the law taught him not to do this.
Yeah.
In other places, he'd say, you were strangers in Egypt. You were afflicted in Egypt. You know what it's like to be afflicted. See, so he'd reason with it, but they weren't that way at all. Now, there are two possible reasons for this unfortunate circumstance. One is that sin hardens people so they don't think of one another. That's one.
Yeah.
The other is that God cuts off all avenues of help so that his work can be seen. I'm inclined that way here. Remember that blind man, they come across a blind man, Jesus and his disciples, and his disciples said, well, who sinned?
Yeah.
This man or some other man or his parents? Who? Jesus said, well, neither this may hath this man sinned nor his parents.
Yeah, right, yeah.
But that the works of God should be made manifest. Yeah. God has put this man here.
Yes.
So I can do a work that's never been done before.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
Up to this time there had never been someone born blind that was received their sight. There had not been even one instance in the whole history of the world, there had not been one instance of a man born blind being given sight.
Uh-huh.
So God positioned this man.
Yeah.
To confirm that what men can't do, God can do.
Amen. Yes.
Jesus can do. That's a very, very difficult lesson for people to learn. I don't want to think about why, because it's kind of discouraging, but it's a difficult lesson for people to learn. That in Christ there is no such thing as a hopeless state. All right, so that's the explanation he gave to Jesus.
Uh-huh.
He didn't know who Jesus was. So Jesus doesn't say, oh, ye of little faith, wherefore did you doubt? See, that's not the appropriate word for him. He said that to Peter, who'd been with him for a while, seen some of his works. This man hadn't. So Jesus just looks at him, and he says unto him, he focuses his words to him, upon him. Now this is important because Jesus' words were with power.
Yeah, amen. Mm-hmm.
And they had spirit and they had life in them. In the beginning all things were made by him. The worlds were framed by his words.
That's
I'm showing
right.
you that his
yeah.
word... Jesus doesn't always have to do something. He just say something.
Yeah.
Just say something, that's all. When he walked among men, the words he spoke were invested with spirit, invested with power. In this case, I'm going to prove it. Now, what a truth is to be seen here. When Jesus tells people to do something, like you read words like be, go, do, be not, Fear not. Be not faithless. See, there's words like this Jesus tells. His word has power. Now, if a person listened to them like they listened to Moses, you can listen to Jesus' words like Israel listened to Moses. I got to do that. When you listen to Jesus like you're supposed to listen to Jesus, you can say, I can do that.
Yeah, amen.
See? Amen. I don't have to be afraid. If Jesus says, fear not, I don't have to be afraid.
Yeah, right.
Let no one imagine you can't do what Jesus tells you to do. Or what someone Jesus sent tells you to do.
Yeah.
Like, here's some things people Jesus sent told us to do. Resist the devil. Be strong. Fight the good fight of faith. Put on the old man. Put off the old man. Run the race. Sin not. See, that's equivalent to saying, rise, take up your bed and walk.
Amen.
But it can be done.
Mm-hmm.
So when you read these things, these divine mandates in Scripture, don't look at them as something, I got to try and do this. Don't, just do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when you set out to do it, then's when the power
Amen.
Kicks
yes.
in.
Yes.
See, actually, about all this man could do is want to get up and walk. That's about all he could do of himself, is just want to. But as soon as he wanted to, he got the power to do it.
Brother Jim, which is what you just went over earlier.
That's why Jesus spoke that first word, was to provoke his want.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
That's right. Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. It's three things. But this man had never done any one of those things. Not even one of them. For the last 38 years, he'd not risen, he'd not picked up his bed, and he hadn't walked for 38 years. How's he going to be able to do it now? By willpower? Can willpower get this done? Now, he does have to be willing, make no mistake about it, but that willingness has to be mixed with divine power.
Amen.
It's got to be mixed with divine power. The word has to be mixed with faith. See, that's what's proved challenging to today's professed Christian. Mixing the word with faith.
Yeah, that's right.
They don't mix it. Yeah, you know what a cake or how a cake could turn out if you didn't mix the ingredients.
Yeah.
That's the same in the world spirit world. There's a mixing that has to be done.
Uh-huh.
Here this word has to be mixed with power and faith, and the word has to be mixed with faith on the part of the man. Now, this is going to require divine initiative. God's got to be the one that does this, but he's looking for someone to do this in. See, he's looking for somebody to do this in. Now he's found that man that he can work with, and he's going to work. Now, you can't take faith and mix it with anything else. You can't take the traditions of men and mix faith with it. It won't work. It won't homogenize. You can't take folklore and mix faith with it. You can't take human opinion and mix faith with it. It won't work. You can only mix it with God's word. See, what has happened in our lifetime, there's been a form of godliness that's been developed that faith can't mix with it. So what happens is ineffective. It doesn't change people. So people are changed by rules and programs and all this sort of thing. It's because the faith can't mix with a procedure.
That's right.
Now notice that when he told them, rise, take up your bed and walk. And he said, immediately, the man is made whole.
Yeah.
And I imagine he thought, what am I doing laying down here? He must have felt in his body like that woman had the issue of blood. She felt in her body she'd been healed. Must have felt, hey, I'm not paralyzed anymore. So immediately, he was made whole. Some of the versions say instantly or straightway or right then, or he was healed on the spot, the Message Bible says. So the man did exactly what Jesus told him to do. He got up, picked up his bed, and walked. Now, under the law, God taught people not to delay. When you're dealing with the things of God, don't be delaying. Don't be putting off. Friends, there's such a thing as offering to God the first fruits, the first ripe fruits. He said, thou shalt not delay to offer the first of thy ripe fruits and of thy liquors. That's the juice from grapes and so forth. The firstborn of thy son shalt thou give to me. Don't delay. Don't delay to do this. As soon as the first grains are ripe, don't wait till you can reap the whole harvest at once. Get those and give them to me right away. The psalmist confessed, I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. Yeah. So, as soon as I knew what you required, I got right to it.
Yeah.
Immediately. That's what this formerly impotent man did. He immediately did what Jesus said. Solomon said, when thou vowest a vow to God, defer not to pay it.
Amen.
Boy, isn't that good?
Yeah.
For he had no pleasure in fools. Pay. That was thou's vow. If you promise God, you do this, I'll do that, or something like that, do it.
That's right.
Don't delay. When Jesus called Peter and called James and John, they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. See? Immediately. When an angel told Cornelius to go to send someone to get Peter, and they got him and brought him back, and Cornelius said, immediately therefore I sent to thee, thou hast done well to come. See, I'm showing that this is the kind of response in the kingdom of God. There's no other response that's acceptable. When Paul and company tried to go to Asia, and God said no. Spirit said no. Can't preach in Asia. Not time yet. Tried to go to Bithynia. No. Can't go to Bithynia. Paul had a dream. He saw in a vision a man in Macedonia saying, come over and help us. He told it to the rest of the brethren. And immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel to them. So they talked it over and said, This is God.
Yeah.
And they immediately set out to do it. John's on the Isle of Patmos.
Yeah.
He hears a voice. Come up hither. He writes, immediately I was in the Spirit.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Paul, he's called by Christ to apostleship. Paul says, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. See, this immediate, all of us could probably do better in this area.
Yeah.
Well, I want to encourage you to make it a point to do better in this area.
Amen.
The quicker you respond to God,
yeah,
the quicker he'll respond to you.
That's right.
That's how it works. You'll experience it.
And each of those responses you mentioned, it's not only an immediate response, but it's also the appropriate one.
Uh-huh.
That's right.
An appropriate response and immediate response can be two different things.
Yeah.
But it's not in any of these cases.
Amen.
Remember, Peter, when he denied Christ, all it took from Christ was a look.
A look.
Mm-hmm.
And the response was immediate, and it was appropriate. Peter repented.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I also think about Elijah, when he's being hidden in the cleft of the rock, and here comes a strong wind and a fire and an earthquake, and then a still small voice. But Elijah was alert, and he immediately responded, and it was an appropriate response.
Amen.
That's what the Lord's people do. They respond immediately,
amen,
but it's not a rash decision with bad choices made.
Now this will make a peculiar person out of you. You'll be the oddball in the court of life, but you'll be happy.
Yes, amen.
You'll be happy. Remember, Jesus is talking. On the day he rose from the dead, still the first day of the week when he rose from the dead, he encountered two men on the road to Emmaus. Remember? They were talking. They were all cast down. So Jesus confronted them, asked them what they were talking about, and they told him. They thought Jesus of Nazareth was the one. We thought he is the one. He said, "Oh, fools and slow of heart." Now, to believe.
Yeah.
Now, sin will make you slow of
right.
heart.
Mm-hmm.
So you're the last one to catch on to what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
You can't see or hear clearly at all.
Mm-hmm.
But faith will make you sharp in this area.
Amen. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, the Lord's
power to heal is not always present. So
yes, right.
when it comes close, when you can perceive that the Lord's calling you into something, that is when grace is available
That's
to do
right.
it right then.
Now, I must tell you that Satan's going to throw up some other stuff to divert
right.
your attention.
Yeah.
He'll throw up some crisis will happen over here.
Uh-huh.
See?
Amen.
So let's not be slow of heart to believe. And then we'll deal with this in our next lesson. This happened on the Sabbath day. So this man entered into a very real rest on the day of rest.
Yes, yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Think what a rest he was experiencing. No more having to go to the pool, no
yeah.
more having to try and get to the edge of the pool. He entered into a rest that
yeah.
day that was absolutely unparalleled.
Amen.
Well, I thank God. This is another one of those unnamed people in the Scripture. Right? I'm persuaded we'll recognize each other in the glory. If Peter and John could recognize Moses and Elijah, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we'll say, "You're that impotent man. You were that impotent man that I
yeah.
read about. And what a blessing you were to me."
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll recognize
Amen.
These people in the glory.
I've wondered if
this man ever made it a point to go back and help someone else.
You might have. And they had to go back and do a little testifying.
Yeah.
Remember me?
Yeah.
I used to be in porch number 2.
Yes.
You remember me, don't you? Amen. And if you have a word you'd like to add tonight? Yeah, Sister Annie?
Considering as you've been talking, in the miracles and the different acts that the Lord performed while he was here, you can see that it was done perfectly and precisely. I've been looking over the account of water turned into wine. And we see in the end of that account how not only did Jesus perform the work, but it was performed perfectly. And
That's
that
right.
the men who beheld the work were able to see this couldn't have been done by any other man.
That's right.
And it, the Lord made it a point to give glory unto God and his works that
mm-hmm.
he did.
Mm-hmm. I pray there'll be more people who make a significant change in their life. And when someone asks why, they won't have to say they went through this program or that program.
Yeah.
To be able to give glory to God.
Amen.
What happened. Anyone else tonight? Yes, Brother Ricky.
You know, whenever the Spirit makes an editorial comment like it being on the day of Sabbath, that's significant.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought of something that was said in the book of Hebrews. It says, "He that hath entered into his rest
yeah.
has ceased from
his own works.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And that's the rest.
That's right.
It doesn't mean you're not doing anything. It means you're ceasing from your own works.
Yeah, you're not
trying.
And that's
what happened mm-hmm. here. This man got up, he took his mat, and he walked. But it was really a work of God
yeah.
in him.
Mm-hmm.
And he had labored hard and long, and it was a burden.
That's right.
There was no burden when that man took up the mat that he had been laying on all those years. And instead of the mat carrying him,
he carried it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which was kind of like a trophy.
Yeah.
That's right.
But
Amen.
It was to him.
Amen.
It was to him a token of what God had done.
That's
in
right.
him. Mm-hmm. And there's no one that knew it better than him.
That's right.
He didn't have to struggle one more time to get to the edge of that pool.
That's
he
right.
ceased from his own labors.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
The Sabbath rest doesn't mean no work.
No.
Uh-huh. It means working through divine work.
Yeah.
That's right.
That was a day of intense work for the priests, remember?
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, Brother Jonathan.
Two things. Yeah, this mentioning of the stirring of the water.
Yeah.
How he brought that up. He said, I'm waiting for that water to get stirred up, but I can't get in. It's really shown the disservice that was done in your previous lesson of omitting that remark about the angel.
Yeah.
Because, you know, just reading it myself, I have these other verses on here, that makes no sense without that there. So it's in a sense, it's like Rich robbed the text. So if someone read that, they've kind of robbed it in a way, because they're like, well, what's he waiting for? What's the stirring of the water? So it just shows it's important to have those details there, because then we get the big picture. The second thing was just, you barely, this man, he hasn't given up. 38 years, he has not given up. He's still there waiting. These are people like Jesus looks for. People who haven't given up. And you can see that in his letters to the churches, where he talked about, well, there's some who haven't defiled their garments. Mm-hmm. And when he says, to him who overcomes, and everyone who overcomes is very much like this man here. They're going to be people who overcame by the Lord's working, by the Lord's power. And so we could have that testimony too. That when he comes and he sees his people still standing, and they have not given up. They're still fighting.
Amen.
You can see in this text that Jesus shakes up the traditional way of thinking. When Jesus asks the man, do you want to be made well? He says, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the pool, but while I'm coming, another steps down before me. And Jesus says, let me give you another way to think about that. The angel comes down and troubles the water, and whoever gets in first is healed. That's what the man saw probably a whole lot while he was sitting there waiting, because he couldn't do it himself.
Yeah.
And then a man comes along and asks him if he wants to be made whole. So he's thinking, do I want to be in that pool when the water is troubled? And he thinks, but I can't get in there. And Jesus says, well, I'll show you another way that's just as valid.
Yeah.
So when you're thinking, I can't do this, then look to Christ. Christ can show you another way.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And when Christ shows you the way, he is the way. But if he shows you another way to go about something, then take that.
Yeah.
Take it and do it. Because when Jesus says, rise, take up your bed and walk, that's exactly what is going to give you the power to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that Jesus, he was the Lord of the angels.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah.
The angels worked for him.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes, Sister Maddie.
If this man stands as an example of all humanity outside of Christ. They're all in this impotent...
That's right.
And the question that Jesus asked him, do you want to be made whole, is kind of reminds me of the way that the law worked, in that it gave a person, it kind of brought this question up,
mm-hmm.
but the answer that the man had was, but I don't have any man. And that's really where the law leaves you.
I want
what God has, but I don't have any way to get it. Mm-hmm. And so then that's where Christ becomes most precious.
Yeah.
And that's why this whole account is, it's like a miniature picture of everything that Jesus had come to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. I recommend sometimes you find a low-down sinner. Ask them, would you like to be forgiven?
Uh-huh.
Ask them, see what they say. Because if they say yes, we have,
he
can step right up.
I would think that this man would perhaps have thought, maybe this man's going to help me in the water.
Right.
You know, maybe he's going to be the one to help me. But he helped him.
He sure did. Yes, Brother Jonathan.
I also enjoy how this... this kind of betrays our own transition into the kingdom, because we have that passage of 1 Corinthians. He says, well, I'd have you know that none of, you know, he lists the people. He said, none shall inherit the kingdom of God. And there's kind of the sense where this man was like, he can't get in.
Yeah.
He can't get in. We were in that state too. You shall not, you can't get in. But he says, but now you're washed.
Yeah.
Now you're washed. So it's like there's that transition where you were like immobile, but now... I could kind of see that in this.
Yes.
That's that sense, that was our previous state.
Yeah. You
can't get in.
That's right.
Yes, but Tony.
The Lord will give you a way to do things that you won't even you've never thought of before.
Yeah.
That's right. Amen.
He'll answer a prayer. He'll give you a way to accomplish something in ways you've never even thought about.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Amen. Yeah, Brother Jim.
Yeah. There was a program. Program was the angel stirs the water, you get in, you're healed. But the problem with the program, it doesn't work for everybody.
That's right, very good.
So, I mean, that's something to think about.
Yes, it is.
I would like to believe that
you know, just as we, mm-hmm. we would say that God doesn't work in a program, we also wouldn't be so dogmatic as to say he can't work in the midst of things like yeah. that. Mm-hmm. But this is an example of the whole thing was bypassed. And the power that had been going from God through the angel, through the water, yeah. to the person getting in, went straight.
Straight to the band. Yeah, amen.
And that is an encouraging thought.
Yeah. Yes,
like
it is.
We talked about earlier in the book about the expeditious nature. It doesn't require long periods of time. It can't happen immediately.
Mm-hmm. Oh, amen.
It doesn't
amen.
Have to go through the normal program set up. It can bypass when Jesus gets
amen.
Involved.
Amen.
I know that that's the kind of solution people want.
Mm-hmm.
So we can announce that's the kind we announce them.
Yes.
All right, Sister Barb.